I've been asked a topic that is very close to my heart, which relates to wasting disease and taking care of the elderly. Don't forget, whatever we do now, in 20 years or so from now, is relevant for ourselves. Of course, maybe also in 30 years, but who knows, sooner or later it will be relevant. And you also may know that my email address, some people have asked me for my business card, and because I finished working for the European Society of Cardiology as vice president, need to create new ones, but my email address is very specific, cachexia.de. I own personally cachexia.com.info.org. Everything related to a wasting disease, I might not look like it, but is actually controlled by me. I'm even running a cachexia society, a cachexia journal, by the way, impact factor 12.5. So these things are, is my other life. And maybe that brings me to the idea of using the convocation address to tell you about my four lives in parallel later on, which I live. And this, you're only seeing right now one of my four lives. Now, cats have seven, I understand, so I'm not as good. Nine in India? Okay, in Germany they have seven. Now, Chennai, 29th of September, and the wasting syndrome of the elderly. If you look into CT scan and you look on the right, you see very much less muscle than on the left. Skeletal muscle wasting is something that is happening ubiquitously in heart failure patients. The summary of about 20 publications in two or three sentences would be that heart failure patients early on in their development as a deteriorating process over time develop muscle wasting in the leg first, and that's probably disuse atrophy. When patients with growing age then also develop muscle wasting in the arms, when they get thin arms, then you should be starting to be concerned. The third level is they start to have global weight loss of the body at large, not then only affecting the muscle tissue, but also the fat tissue. So the muscle is the early problem, and it's directly a problem of performance, but the fat tissue in the end. When this is going, then you have a prognostic problem. And I come back later when I talk about therapy. This has some interesting consequences. You know, it's always important to show something that you make people believe you understand pathophysiology and have these many arrows. Life is complex, and I can tell you, triggering of body wasting is complex, and certainly curing body wasting is likely even more complex. At the moment, we can't really achieve it. So these things are all interrelated. When you want to discuss a new thing, many people believe that you need to be able to define a problem in order to treat a problem. We can have a nice philosophical debate later on, maybe also at the convocation address, whether this statement is true. I can easily take the point that it is not true. You just need to be successful in your treatment, and then the definition comes from your success. But that's a different discussion. So what is sarcopenia? Well, there is one view of sarcopenia as having this isolated as the muscle wasting of the elderly, unrelated to chronic illness. However, who really is an elderly without some form of a chronic illness? And therefore, this is a bit of an artificial discussion point. So there has now been a school of thought to call muscle wasting of the elderly as such primary sarcopenia and muscle wasting due to underlying chronic illness, secondary sarcopenia. More important is that you need to have some degree of impaired function. So sarcopenia with limited mobility, and if you, for instance, have a walking speed of less than 1 meter per second, which means in a 4-meter test, you need more than 4.0 seconds. And that is the official frailty sarcopenia test, a 4 meter gait speed, then you really perform poorly, or a 6 minute walk test below 400 meters. More recently, the FDA said 350 meters and less, plus some degree in less skeletal muscle. You should always distinguish the aging muscle wasting, sarcopenia, from frank cachexia and frailty. Don't forget, frailty can be psychologically as much as it can be physical. To contrast this with the cachexia definition, really frank weight loss affecting muscle and fat tissue is the key there, and it goes along with poor performance and biochemical abnormalities. When you talk about weight loss in the elderly, you will not hear me talk about intentional compared to unintentional weight loss. I personally believe that intentional weight loss is not possible. This is not so much a statement of personal experience, it's a statement of scientific fact. If you look here, for instance, into a study done in America with veterans, they were told how good it is to lose weight because it changes your cardiovascular risk profile. They then were asked whether the weight loss they did was voluntary or involuntary. And that's the only thing you can use to distinguish this. There is no objective way of classifying a weight loss as voluntary. You can only ask the person. Then the prognosis was analyzed, and it was found that patients with voluntary or involuntary weight loss both had much poorer prognosis than the elderly people without the weight loss to begin with. So weight loss is always bad until proven otherwise. That's maybe the biggest story for the elderly. Cachexia is frequent. If you ask me about your elderly people, what is the most frequent cachexia? It's actually COPD cachexia. Heart failure is second. Cancer is less often. And don't forget, in cancer, you have a very high turnover. Many of these patients die very fast. That's why the prevalence is less. And also, you have a segmented field because you have so many different cancers associated with muscle wasting. Now, when you have the elderly, the skeletal muscle is the reason for the symptoms. You have the heart failure, you have other chronic illnesses causing the skeletal myopathy, but the most important thing is that when you have changes in the sympathetic activation in the reflex system, that you get changes in what is called the metaboergoreflex. Now, when was the last time that you walked 10 flights of stairs up? I did this kind of, I think, 2 days ago in Armenia. And I can tell you, when you walk 10 flights of stairs, you start to feel sour muscle. Of course, you don't feel sour. What you feel is a metabolic stress. And that sensation comes through metaboergoreceptors in your skeletal musculature, sensing pH changes. This sensing of pH changes goes to your brain and tells your brain we have a metabolic problem. Breathe more. Then you try to start to breathe more, and first of all, higher frequency of breathing than you might feel. But if the inability of breathing more is matched with a signal, or dismatched actually, with a signal to breathe even more, that is called shortness of breath. A strong signal for muscle to breathe more and a practical inability to breathe more, that is shortness of breath. When you then compare these patients with and without skeletal muscle wasting, yes, the patients with muscle wasting, they are lower in BMI, they are somewhat older, and you might say that they also have less female gender. So female sex is protective against this to some degree. These patients, of course, are to some degree also more symptomatic and more inflammatory. These patients have poorer performance if you take peak VO2 or exercise time. These patients have poorer hand grip strengths. So you start to see different tests because now you're talking geriatric medicine. Hand grip strength is one thing, but even the 4 meter walk test is another thing you can use. You can get in the elderly medicine, you can get a drug approved based on a change in the performance of the 4 meter gait speed. 4 meters, that's all it takes to get a drug approved. When you then try to analyze the reasons why there is poor performance by exercise capacity standard testing, muscle wasting comes out as a strong independent factor. So this is really a target for future treatment. If you look into our guidelines, well, yes, we now have a section on cachexia and sarcopenia of the elderly and frailty, but there is nothing much in it in terms of practical advice. What could be in it is to change the catabolic-anabolic balance. Again, a nice term, but what can we practically do? Anabolic factors, exercise, maybe testosterone, and I will show you a little bit on this, and catabolic factors to block. Of course, neuroendocrine inhibition comes to mind. Just one point about exercise training, a standard training comparison trial, and let me only say, skeletal muscle inulin-like growth factor, a strong local anabolic, is increased by exercise. So exercise is actually anabolic. If you believe that exercise can reduce your body weight, then I'm sorry to say this doesn't work. It doesn't work in heart failure. It doesn't also work for your life. Because when you start to do proper more exercise, you will also eat more. And in the end, you definitely gain muscle, you lose fat, but you don't lose body weight. But the aim of exercise should not be losing of body weight, it should be gaining of muscle and losing of fat tissue. If you're too lazy to do exercise, there's alternatives available. Electrical stimulation trousers. They were actually developed originally for East German sports people in rehabilitation for the next Olympic championship. So electrical muscle stimulation as a training where you can, if you like, in a lazy armchair, do this. And it's definitely possible for at least rehabilitation level of muscle training, it works. Strength gaining is difficult. It's needs to be done really severe electrical stimulation. I've done this a few times just to try out. It's not really fun. You can do this and you gain strength in heart failure patients, particularly when you do it with big muscles. So if you try to do this, that's why this was done with trousers. Gluteus maximus is a very good place to consider. So muscle wasting treatment has different targets, and the protein synthesis is one. Ghrelin, shall we say, was tried. There's a human small study from Japan, 10 subjects, no control, and also some animals. Very positive results, but as I said, no control. And in the meantime, oral ghrelin was tested in cancer, cachexia, was completely neutral, and I don't think this is moving anywhere. Testosterone. Well, there is some pretty good data actually in male heart failure patients with low testosterone values. Unfortunately, there is still too much reluctance by elderly men to accept that they might have low testosterone values. But trust me, if you start to correct this, you might even see better results than with iron. These studies are very positive in results, but now the exciting thing is it also works in women. Of course, with lower levels of testosterone treatment, but testosterone reduction in women at their own levels is a serious issue about skeletal muscle loss and can be corrected. The only problem really is this is too cheap. Nobody wants to do these treatments large scale. So we need to invent more expensive things. And anti-muscle wasting therapies have, of course, been invented, and there is several big companies doing this now. We shall see where this is going, but I can promise you the regulators of muscle growth are very heavily investigated, including myostatin and the activin receptor. And sooner or later, I'm very positive, there will be things. Now, the overall balance can also be changed. And one of the very simple things you can do is give patients the proper heart failure therapy, neuroendocrine activation as a stimulus for catabolic, anabolic imbalance is important. The first report we had on this was 2003. ACE inhibitors preventing weight loss. That's an anti-cachexia effect. This had zero impact in the heart failure space because people were giving the ACE inhibitors anyway. This had quite a big impact in cancer where this is also possible. And it had the impact because the neuroendocrine activation in cancer and in any other cachexia indeed is very similar. Few data for angiotensin II, but we have similar data also for norepinephrine and aldosterone. And the exciting group is this one. If you have weight loss because of starvation, you do not have neuroendocrine activation. You only have it because of chronic illness-mediated cachexia. Then beta blockers. The average beta blocker, and we have data for several different ones, gives you 1 to 1.5 kilogram weight gain per year. 1 to 1.5 kilogram per year. I come back to this in a second. The weight gain you see, you can also express this in when does a patient achieve 5% weight gain. We have published this now. Highly positive results with carvedilol. You can achieve this quite easily with a beta blocker. What is the weight gain you see with a beta blocker? If you might believe they make you fat, you are correct. 70% of the weight gain with a beta blocker of this kind is actually fat tissue. But that also means 30% is muscle tissue, so that's the good news. But they are protecting against lipolysis. So fat tissue dissolution is blocked by beta blockers. Muscle is important, but fat is also important. So let me conclude at this stage, and a little bit I will also extend on this in the convocation address later. The treatment of the elderly with muscle wasting and possibly cachexia is a multimodal treatment in the future. Parts of it you're already doing, neurohormonal inhibition, maybe exercise, but good food intake is also a key issue. And this is probably the solution for the future in this whole field. And then the assessment of patients is actually fairly simple, but they are somewhat easier, but also different tests done. And the short physical performance battery, the 4-meter gait speed, are such tests. But the summary message is this. Taking care of these patients as you are also geriatricians. And we need to start to view the whole field like this. Thank you so much for your attention.